We will consider this time as the first part of my talk, qualities of information. Quality is a concept which is not very precisely definable. It is something like a beauty of a person, but when one sees the quality, person knows that it is good quality. So the exact definition is not really there, but on the other hand, if there are certain properties which the resulting information after processing follows, and if you are make sure that the method of collecting data as well as processing data follows certain minimum standards, required standards, then the resulting effect will be that of an information with good quality. We have been emphasizing right from the beginning that information is processed data. So, in order to ensure the quality of information, you have to first ensure the correctness of data, and also you have to ensure the correctness of processing. So, the most important part or the basic requirement is accuracy in terms of the correct data input and the correct processing rules which you follow. Normally, processing rules are really incorporated in some kind of a program. So, the program has to be correct in order to be able to ensure that the processed data, namely information, is also correct. There is a very old saying in data processing called GIGO, G-I-G-O, garbage in, garbage out. What it really means is that if the data input is incorrect, whatever processing you may do, the output is going to be incorrect or not of right quality. This is true in everything. You may have the best possible recipe to make a dish like upma, but if you give input where the suji which is given is full of sand, whatever you make in terms of the correct recipe following and doing the correct process in cooking, the output will be not so edible. So, this is always important to make sure that the input data is correct. Now, there are a number of methods of ensuring that whatever data you input is reasonably correct. You have to make sure. And in fact, later on in the course, you will see, in fact, there is a whole lot of almost a whole lecture I will devote later on to see how to ensure the accuracy of input data which gets into a system. The reason I am emphasizing it again and again is that when you write programs in a classroom or small projects and so on, the volume of data you deal with is not very large. The volume of data is maybe at the most 100 or 200 data points you work with. But in real data processing systems, the volume of data you handle is enormous. For instance, if you are going to process the examination results of CET, CET is taken by lakhs of candidates, and so the number of input data which will get into the program to be processed will run into several lakhs. So, when the volume becomes very large, it is much more difficult to ensure correctness at every point. So, that is the reason why one has to have special methods of ensuring data correctness when you are dealing with large volumes of data, because typically most real life data processing systems will deal with lakhs and lakhs of data and not a small amount of data. Of course, the correctness of program is a different issue, and there is a lot of work which has been going on in terms of ensuring the correctness of programs. That is, from the given specifications to get to the right program to do that is itself a major challenge in software design, and a lot of time is spent on various methods of ensuring the quality or the correctness of programs or processing rules in this case. So, the first thing is accuracy, but that is not sufficient, because quality, as I pointed out, is not a quantified one single scalar. It depends upon a number of different aspects of the information you get out with. Just like, you know, beauty is not a single thing. You know, beauty, when you say about beauty of a girl, you do not really say only about how her face looks, but you also look at the way she deports herself, various other aspects which are there. It is not a single quantity which defines an esoteric thing like beauty. So, there are other aspects which you also have to consider, and the other most, I am going to list many of them, and I will explain what each one of them really means. And at the end of whatever processing you do to provide information to the management or to people to use it, information. What I mean by management is that you may be actually looking at operational day to day data processing, or you may be looking at tactical information to come out of the operational information, or strategic information, whatever be the information which you present, all of them have to adhere to these quality standards. And so, the important second aspect of quality is what I call completeness. What by completeness we mean, in processing, all the data which are relevant for that processing should be taken into account or incorporated. You should not by mistake leave out some part of a data which is there. Imagine CET results processing, where you forgot to include one sentence data completely. That sentence data is not included. When you do the processing, ultimately what you get is these set of students who took the exam in a particular center are not in the results. So, there will be a furor all over the place. So, this is a situation where the input data is not complete, and some part of it is missed. Maybe due to carelessness, maybe whatever it is, you really have to make sure that whatever data has to be taken into account has to be taken into account. It has to be timely. What I mean by timely is information which is presented too late is not much use. Like, for instance, you expect a newspaper to come every morning to give you news of what happened the previous day and so on. So, people read newspapers every morning to be able to be informed about the current events, and you suppose it is delivered one day late, then that is as good as being thrown in the waste paper basket. Something which has not come on time is very often not useful at all for any purpose. So, timeliness means when the information is required, at that time you have got to present it. There is no point in delaying it. If you are doing, for instance, a day to day stock taking, the result of what is the stock at the end of the day should be known at the end of the day. There is no point in talking about what stock was there 1 week ago. So, if you take a long time to process and your results are always out of date, then the decisions you take will not be correct because they will be based on outdated information. So, everything has got to be timely. There is also a quality called trustworthiness. Trustworthiness is something different from completeness. Completeness means you include all data items. Trustworthiness means intentionally you should not leave out certain data so that the results look good. Okay, so you cannot trust that information if it happens that you have not included unpleasant information. For instance, if you are presenting to a visiting group about the performance of your company, and if you remove from that presentation many transactions where effectively you made a loss, then the results you give are not trustworthy. Sooner or later people will find out that what has been given is incorrect and has been done, but it is done intentionally, then of course it is also an offense. In fact, in the recent past many such situations have arisen where companies have hidden information which are not pleasant, like a certain kind of losses which the company made were not made known to the stockholders. And so they come up in fact in America with a new law which punishes people who hide information intentionally, and some of them are actually going to jail. Similar things are happening all over the world. That is, because of computer processing of information, people, and also because of the fact that the volume of data is increasing in leaps and bounds, to get into every aspect is very difficult. So, certain amount of trust is placed on the management, and so trust, the management which looks after the company should ensure that whatever they do is trustworthy. The other quality is what we call relevance. There is relevance means something which is which is useful for a person, and if it is something which is not useful, it is called irrelevant. Take a very simple example. When you open your email box every morning, you find a few letters which are essentially meant for you, but the whole lot of other letters come which are advertisements trying to sell things like that, and many people call it spam. In fact, it is called spam, and all that spam hides the real information which you require, namely the letters which are intended for you. So, the relevance of what you get from the email system is not very good unless you have some kind of a what is known as a filter, which filters out all the unwanted or spam information and presents only the wanted mail to you, and that is an important part of any relevance. In fact, this has taken a greater and greater importance with the coming of the automated search engines on the internet. Search engines people use all the time, like Google nowadays is very commonly used by students and everybody to be able to search the web to get information which is relevant. You may like to find out for instance what is the latest speed of a DRAM chip which is made by whichever company, that is the fastest chip being made in the world today, and you put a query which will have say DRAM speed and so on. But many of these systems will retrieve so much data that it will wade through that to really find out what is the one which you really wanted. So, it is like searching for a needle in a proverbial haystack. It takes a long time. So, many people in fact do not go to a search engine for a simple reason that they will get 2000 hits, what they call hits, 2000 outputs, then they really require only 2 or 3 outputs. And so, the irrelevance measure in this case is that it is 98% of what you got is not relevant, only 2% is relevant. So, that means if it is relevant information, you are actually wasting your time. Okay. So, relevant information is essentially what any management needs from any information system. Because I broaden my area of information system to include systems such as Google, because it, after all, it is also an information system which searches the web. And in fact, today's world, it has become a very important information system which everybody uses. So, the better, if somebody comes up with a better so called search engine, will give you a much higher relevance ratio. That is, what you get out of the net is, suppose 98% is relevant, only 2% is irrelevant, then you would normally switch to that kind of an engine. Okay. Because there is no engine which is can really give you 100%, because very often people do not even know very clearly what they want. So, they kind of put the search terms in a very careless way, and you end up with a whole lot of junk information coming on the on your screen. So, relevance is very important from the point of view of any system. A brief summarize information, and that is summarize relevant information, is very useful, because brevity is as they say the soul of good writing as well as good systems. Your brevity essentially ensures that you get the essence of what you require, and a lot of inessential things are being left out. So, briefness becomes much more important as you go up in the hierarchy of any organization. The higher the level of a manager in the organization, the briefer will be the information presented to him, because the higher level managers are highly paid, they have lots of things to do, and they do not have time to wade through a whole lot of irrelevant thing which is not presented with brevity or brief. So, it is very important as you go along. In fact, strategic information is supposed to be the briefest of the lot, and of course, the operational information is quite detailed, but even there I think a lot of operational information may not be all that useful. So, you may like to kind of make sure that what you present is necessary and sufficient for the purpose for which it is designed. Another idea about quality is what is known as up to date. Up to dateness and timeliness are two different concepts. What is meant by up to date is that all data up to the last minute is included. Like for instance, if you take a newspaper example again, a newspaper may be timely, you will get it in the morning, first thing in the morning. But if the information contained in it, the news contained in it is 1 week old or old news, then it is not up to date, even though it is timely. Same way, if you are processing data and you are leaving out current data, that is data of which happened in the very recent past, and include all data which happened in the earlier, then what you are really getting is not up to date. So the advantage of using computers is the speed with which the machines can process data. So the speed is irrelevant if what you get out of the computer is not up to date. So the speed has got to be matched with the with the fact that you should be able to include all data till the time, you might say within quotes, the data is fed to the machine. Okay, so this is important. Or as they say in newspapers, up to press time, when they go to the press at that time, whatever news comes in, they include that. And sometimes they put it as a late news, and saying that. And in TV channels and so on, they have a breaking news. They're saying that it's up to date, the new news is just coming up, and they update all the time. So between two channels, TV channels, the channel which is able to break the news faster is considered a better channel than a channel which is not able to give the news immediately, but it kind of delays it, right? So up to dateness is an important quality. Significance is another idea. That is, significance is that when something is presented to you, you should be able to understand what it really means. Like for instance, at the end of the year, the finance minister presents his budget, and the budget is a whole lot of numbers. Those numbers do not make much sense to common man. But normally they give a pie chart, a circle, a chart in which they said, out of the income I have received, so much income has come from income tax, so they will show a pie. That is, 30% has come from income tax, some 40% has come from indirect taxes, and some part has come from loans, and so on. They show a chart, and as soon as you look at the chart, you have clarity in terms of where the money has come in from. Similarly, the budget also says where it is going to be spent. So in the same chart, they will say this much percentage, say 30% is being spent on defense, 5% on education, 10% on health care, and so on, and 40% or 50% on salaries. People immediately wake up saying that you are spending a lot of money on salaries for people and not enough money on improving the education or improving the infrastructure and so on. So by and large, when you look at a chart like that, you understand immediately the relevance of what is being presented. And this same point arises in day-to-day information processing also, because the budget is not only a budget of the country, but for a company, they have to make a budget every year, and in that budget you have to say how much are you, from which areas of operation of the company are you getting highest percentage of money. So in this case, I will put more emphasis on that area which is giving me a lot of income. Then I can ask the question, which area is giving me higher profitability? So then in the profit and loss account, I have another chart which tells which items in my company's manufacture made the maximum percentage profit. Then I would like to emphasize on producing more of that. Okay. So there is these kinds of, if you understand significance of information, then you can take a decision which the people call informed decision. Okay. Informed decision will in the long run make the company go very, very profitable. See, otherwise the company will start losing money. Okay. So primarily then we talked about all the aspects of quality. So the quality considerations are important regardless of the type of information you are designing, whether it is information for operational reasons, operational information, or tactical or strategic, any, all of them require good quality. There may be more emphasis on certain types of qualities for certain types of information. Like for strategic decision making, it is much more important to be able to give information which is, whose significance is understood and also brief. Okay. And for operational information, you require to make sure that it is complete, that it is trustworthy. Okay. And you also make sure that it is up to date and timely. These are things which are essential for operational information. That does not mean that it is not relevant for or important for others. Strategic information also has got to be up to date and timely. But what I am trying to say is that some of the quality parts are lot more important as you go higher up in the hierarchy than others. But by and large, all these parameters of quality had to be satisfied in designing any information system, and you had to make sure of that. So, having talked about quality of information and various, we also looked at different parts of a company and so on. Now, we will get into the types of information systems which are normally designed for use. The reason why I am going to talk about the types of information system or varieties of information systems is because each of them have a certain role to play, and they have got different names for that reason. There is always a very lot of confusion in the minds of people about the terminology. I would like to divide the terminology of variety into three broad categories. One is business data processing. Business data processing primarily is day to day processing of large volumes of data, and that is the one, for instance, which every company has to do. So, business data processing is an essential part of any system. You cannot avoid it, but it is all routine. Once you have that, then people confuse this business data processing with what is known as management information system, which is very often abbreviated as MIS system or MIS. MIS, the reason why it is confused with data processing is that both of them are used by managers. So, management information system is also based on data processing systems. But I would like to kind of look at it from the point of view of our classification of tactical information. That is, operational information is voluminous, as I said. Tactical information is based on the operational information and further processing of the operational information to get some amount of brevity and relevance, which is of use to middle managers for taking their tactical decisions day to day. So, the input to an MIS is the output of the business data processing system. So, the input is one, the output is MIS, a management information system. It is a system which whose output is tactical information. The next level, next higher level is often called decision support system. As the name implies, the system is to ensure good decision making by top management of any company. So, decision making is very often done by both middle managers and by top managers, but more often the MIS results are presented to the top management by the middle management, and they use these MIS results to be able to take some decisions using a system called decision support system. The nature of a decision support system is somewhat different from the nature of a business data processing system. This I will explain as I go along. Later on, we will have a greater explanation of what DSS means, and books have been written on DSS because it is a fairly interesting area of data processing, and it is fairly challenging area of data processing. And so, getting a decision support system very often is very important for a company, and general feeling among the community of people who do software system design and so on is that we have not reached a stage, very good stage, of being able to give very good DSS. Still, lots of decisions taken by companies, particularly strategic decisions taken by top management, is not only based on the data presented by using or massaging MIS operational system and so on. Over and above this, they have to use a lot of their own what is known as grade point data. There is data and things like that which they hear in them as a buzz or rumors and stuff like that, and they use their general long term view of where economy is going, where a country is going, and so they bring upon whatever facts and figures are presented to them, also what is known as judgment. They have judgment and use this judgment combined with the facts and figures to arrive at decisions which they consider is a decision which will lead to a profitable company in the long run. And these strategic decisions which are supposed to come from DSS are not always correct. Very large number of companies have gotten into difficulties because they took wrong strategic decisions by reading the market or situation somewhat incorrectly. One very interesting example which has occurred in the very recent past is there are two things which happened. One is IBM, for instance, sold their entire PC business to a Chinese company called Lenovo. Now, one may ask, see, PC is a very large area, a lot of people use PCs. Why is it that a company which really invented the PC gave up their entire business to a Chinese company? There is a strategic decision. What the top management feels is that maybe the days of the PCs is coming to an end. Some other technology is going to come. The other important thing which of course made them base this decision is that when they look at their profitability, for the amount of money invested, amount of human resources invested, the profitability of PCs is very small because the margins which you get in the sale of PCs is very small, few percent. And the competitors like Dell and so on, who are able to cut costs, which a large company finds it difficult to cut costs. So, IBM's profitability on PCs is going down, whereas their profitability in another area like servers, which are for high end uses, for the number of servers they sell, the percentage money they get is much more. So even the volume may be low, but the percentage profit is very high. So in their balance sheet, they find that the contribution which comes from the servers is much higher. So maybe we should emphasize on that, spend our money as well as human resource and everything on that, and sell this off and get as much money as we can get from that and plunk it into the other area. So this is a kind of a decision based on decision support system, which effectively gave them this chart giving the profitability of servers versus profitability of PCs. Of course, there is only one what I would call numerical aspect which they had, but the other aspect is that what I would say gut feeling, the feeling that maybe in the long run there is then going to be some kind of a saturation or profits going to go down and things like that. On the other hand, Hewlett Packard acquired a PC company called Compaq and made a larger company, and they found that having done that, they are losing money. So that is again a similar decision. In one case they sold off their PC business, in the other case they acquired a PC business. So what has happened is that the acquisition of that PC business by HP made their profits go down. Immediately the stockholders or people or shareholders were very unhappy, and what they did was sack the person who took the decision. That is the top management, as one top manager of HP, and because of taking the wrong decision, strategic decision, she lost her job. Okay. So in other words, these are what I would say, maybe our judgment is incorrect, okay, but partly it is based on data, because Compaq was making good money, but probably they didn't look at the possibility of competition and so on. So strategic decisions also sometimes backfire one way or the other, but informed decision support systems or correct information fed to DSS helps a lot in terms of coming up with a proper type of a decision. Let us start with the lowest of the rung of information systems, namely business data processing systems. In business data processing systems, as I said, a typical example of a business data processing system would be a system to process the CET results. As I pointed out, the input is lakhs and lakhs of data. So all this data enters the processing system, and now you have to make sure that the data which is being fed to whatever program you have written is complete and it is correct. So you have to make sure that errors are removed, so it is called editing. In editing, you use a lot of rules, lot of rules of thumbs as well as real rules. And sometimes if you do not have proper editing, the data which gets in is corrupted or incorrect, and the results would be bad. See, unnecessarily some student may lose opportunity because of incorrect data entry. So it is the responsibility of data being entered to make sure. So edit programs do that. Simple example of an editing which I would give is like, say, in CET, There may be 3 subjects or 4 subjects, whatever number you may take. So if it turns out that after data entry you find that a student got 90 and 90 in 2 subjects and got 0 and 0 in 2 other subjects, the probability that that data is wrong is very high. So the system in the ERIC stage should be able to point out such discrepancies so that one can go back and check whether incorrect data has been entered and correct it at that point itself. So checking the ERIC programs are a very, very, very important part of any data processing system. In fact, I remember that in companies which used to do a massive data processing, like for instance CED results, results of examinations like matriculation examination, SLC examination or pre-university and so on, those companies used to spend a lot of effort and time in writing ERIC programs. And very often when a student joined a company as a trainee, one of the early jobs was given to the person was to write ERIC programs to kind of make sure the student understands the importance of data getting into system being correct. Later on in the course, we will look at in great detail the methods of editing. And editing, there are 2 aspects of editing. One is of course removing incorrect data. The other aspect of editing is that including all data. What as I pointed out, if you lost, you know, if you didn't include one particular center, then what you end up with is a very bad result. Similarly, in a single center, suppose say 55 students took the test and you entered only 54 data, then you missed one. So there must be some method of checking completeness. So this is called control. So at the end of a batch of say 55, you put one control which counts and says, I have really read so many input data. And with that number is smaller than the number of students who took the exam, then immediately you know that it is incomplete. So editing and control check to say, see whether it is complete, and also reasonable. Like for instance, if you are processing data of a class and you look at the age field, and for say class 10 in a school, you find an age to be 35, immediately you have to have a doubt whether data is entered correctly or not. So this is what is meant by reasonableness check. You got to be you have to have some reasonableness about what is being entered. So apart from the what I mean by say incorrect data entry, very often leads to unreasonable things. So that is something which comes out with control checks. So you have to then, that means what you are really doing is the input data is being taken and you are polishing it or sending it through a laundry to clean it up and take out all the incorrect data, correct all of it, and what ultimately gets into the system is normally stored in what is known as a database. So before things get into the database, you have to make sure that what is put in the database is correct and complete. So the organization of the database is only how to really organize all this massive volume of data, but what gets into that is what comes out of the earlier part of a data processing system, namely editing, control checks and so on and so forth. There are also certain aspects which are spot audit. People do spot audit to really find out if anything which intentionally has been changed, whether you know those things are also done. We will look into it in great detail as you in the later on in the course. There are in the data processing itself, there are two broad methods of data processing. One is called online transaction processing, the other is called batch processing. The CET examination processing, which I talked about, is an example of batch processing, because you bunch all the result, all the data. There is a having taken the examination, marks are assigned, and you are taking the marks of each student with the roll number and so on, and you are taking, as I said, lakhs and lakhs of these data together as a batch and process it as a batch. This is a routine data processing day to day. What I mean by day to day is CET is not day to day, CET is a periodic, say CET is once a year. There are other types of batch data processing which are periodic, like payroll. If you are doing a payroll processing, at the end of the month, to give the salary to your employees, you got to get the records of all employees, their salaries, deductions, all those things, and process it, and create an account, and then find out how much money is to be credited to the bank account of that employee, and automatically that amount is credited to the bank. So, this is a periodic type of a data processing. So, payroll is an example. This also, the frequency can be daily, payroll is once a month. A daily frequency is something like at the end of the day, if you are finding out the inventory in your company, like if you are running a large retail store like Food World or something like that, at the end of the day, you would like to have an idea of the current stock position. And the current stock position is got to be there, and you got to process at the end of the day, and that is got to be there. Depends upon what you know, the method may differ, but by and large it is periodic data processing. Or if you are doing cash collection, at the end of the day you have to find out how much cash you collected. So, you add up all the cash, whatever was entered in the cash register, and you go on and update, you know, adding up all that and give the cash at the end of the day. So, then at the end of the month you will find out the total monthly cash inflow. So, these are things which are data processed, I mean batch processed. There is then the OLTP is something somewhat different. It is called online data transaction processing. What is meant by online is being done immediately after the event. Like for instance, if you are going to book your railway ticket at the reservation counter, you are being processed online, because as soon as you give a request for a ticket, that form, whatever information is contained in that form, is entered by that clerk, and immediately that gets into the system. And while you are waiting, the result comes out telling you whether ticket is available, and if a ticket is available, your ticket is also printed and given to you. So, it is online in that sense, that is it is working while you are waiting. A transaction means the slip you gave requesting for a seat in a train, once it is entered, it is a transaction. So, one entry has been made, and this triggers a number of other things in the background. This particular input will trigger a lookup in the database to find out if there is a ticket available and create this ticket out. The reason why the term transaction processing is being used is because it came from the banking area. When you go to a bank and present a check, whatever is in the check is being entered on a PC right away, and there is a transaction, there is a money transaction, and the money transaction leads to a reduction in your account, and that is being debit your account, and then you get money out. Another very common example of online transaction processing are all the ATMs. ATMs which are there all over the place are really online transaction processing machines, because you go there, put in your card, and that card is read as a transaction, and it triggers an action. The action, triggering an action, leads to a cash coming at your end. There are a number of other issues which comes up with online transaction processing, which make it somewhat challenging to design such systems. These challenges come because of the fact that there could be two transactions coming simultaneously on the same data, and you have to be able to make sure that one of them is committed before the other is committed, because both of them cannot conflict. I give a simple example. You may be withdrawing money from a bank. At the same time, you are given your, you may be doing ATM, your wife may be doing an ATM transaction on the same account. And so, if there is not enough money, if both of them are done without proper committing, what I mean by committing is, as soon as one transaction is over, your balance should go down. If it hasn't gone down, the balance remains the same, and the other transaction also takes place, then you get money which is not in your bank, not in your account. So it is a mistake which has occurred. So this kind of a serializing of transactions, it becomes important in online transaction processing systems. Because batch processing, I already talked about the various batch processing methods. In online transaction processing, database or a master file, as it is called, is available online, like in a ticket booking situation, for you to be able to do the work immediately. Request in specified format is accepted by from the requester as a form or something like that, and check the request for validity, retrieve record from database, and take appropriate action. Either give you a ticket or not give you a ticket, tell you are on the waiting list or whatever. So every alternate transaction processing has got this thing, whereas in batch processing you collect a batch of requests, key in, validate or edit check, create a request file. So from this batch you create a file, and this file is called a transaction file, because you bunched up all together into a file, and update the master file based on the transaction file. In one instance and for all, in other words, the transaction file gets in, and one by one it goes and checks the database entries, updates it. At the end of the file, the master file or master transaction, master database gets updated, gets a new state, and then create the result file. Like if you are a payroll, the result file will be a set of checks to be printed, and print response to requests. Okay. Like exam processing also. In the case of requests is the results of the examination. After CET, create a result file result file is printed and you get your big sheets of results, which you put on the board or put it on the web or whatever for students to understand or know. In the difference between batch and OLTP is that in OLTP the requirement is that the response time should be very fast. What is meant by response time is from the time you initiate a transaction to the time you get your result of the transaction, the elapsed time should be small for obvious reasons. See, while you are waiting in a queue to get you served for your ticket, you do not want to be waiting for half an hour to get a ticket. As soon as you get first in the queue and you present your form, you are very happy. You already stood for half an hour maybe in the queue. Now you are happy that you got your turn. When you got your turn, if it takes another half an hour, you will get very frustrated because people do not like to wait in queues and wait and so on for a simple reason that they think it is a waste of time. And it is in fact a waste of time, and nobody wants to kind of unnecessarily stand around and waste time. So the response time is very, very important, and the response time should be not more than a minute or two. Okay, if it goes beyond 5 minutes, people start fiddling around. Response time also depends upon the situation. When you're using a computer PC, and then you enter something, and the results doesn't come out, and you go on waiting that little hourglass goes on round and round and round, you get very frustrated because the response time is not good. When you are working on a terminal on a PC, you would like to have a response time of a few seconds, 2 or 3 seconds. Otherwise, you feel you start fidgeting. You think maybe the computer is down, or maybe there's some problem with the machine. On the other hand, the machine may be slow. Okay. So the point really is, in any kind of an online situation, it is very important to be able to get a quick response. In a batch processing system, the requirement is not immediate processing, because anyhow you have bunched up everything together. See, CET examination results, after you get all the exam results in and input the data, which takes a lot of time because it is maybe manual and so on. The computer time to process is not all that, it is only a very small fraction of the total time from the time you give the examination to the time your result is declared. So that part, what is more important is, from the point of view of the computer, the computer's time should be preserved. So in other words, the throughput or the efficiency with which it gets processed in the computer to reduce or minimize the CPU time becomes important. So throughput is an important consideration for a batch processing system. In fact, this throughput versus response is a recurring theme in a lot of computer science. When you do a design of a computer, for instance, you can design a computer to maximize throughput. Particularly, if you are designing a server which serves multiple terminals or multiple PCs. In a server, from the point of view of the person who is getting to the server, that is from your PC, you would like to have very quick response. So from individual's point of view, response is important. But from the person who manages that server, he has to get the maximum utilization of that server to get as much work done as possible without any idle time of that server. So from his point of view, the throughput is important. So this kind of a design of a system, you try to balance the two, response time versus throughput. If you try to improve the throughput, response goes down. If you make the response very good, then throughput goes down. So this trade-off is always there. And of course, in data processing, you really look at two different types of systems. OLTP, the benchmarks which are used to assess the performance of the computer is quite different from what you use for batch. So at that time, you know very clearly that one is a minimum response system, the other is a minimum throughput system. I think this is the right time to kind of stop this talk, and next time we will continue with the discussion.